I wanted to ask about the Behind the Curve movie
Sure.
because I saw that the other day, and then I had my mom watch it because she doesn't understand anything about what I've been talking about lately.
Right.
She doesn't really understand it, and I was wondering about it because who made it?
Okay. Well, it was made by a small group out of Los Angeles called Delta V Productions.
Okay.
The guy that, and I think you may have seen him once or twice in the film, but you can look him up. His name was Daniel Clark. He was the director. And he contacted me at the beginning of 2017. So, like, right after I got back from Canada, because I was up there for a year. And he said, "Hey, I'd like to, I'm curious about this thing. Would you mind, me flying up to Seattle and talking to you for a bit?" And so he flew up, and we met over pizza on Whidbey Island, and we talked, I think, for like 30 minutes. He said, "You know what? This is too interesting not to start filming." So, we started shooting, and then more and more people got involved, and they got Bob and Jaron and Patricia and Nathan and Chris Pontius and all that. And we went to, quite a few locations, and it took the better part of 7 months to shoot everything to where they finally wrapped up in November. Most of it was done in November at the Raleigh conference. And we only realized later that Daniel, I mean, again, some flat earthers may disagree with me when I say this, but it was supposed to be a human interest piece. That's what the whole thing. It's like, okay, forget about the nuts and bolts of flat Earth. It's about the people of flat Earth and who's in it. And then when he got to Raleigh, he realized that flat Earth wasn't just some flash in the pan thing. It's a whole new paradigm change, and he was starting to get worried. And in fact, if you listen to the you probably watched it on what, Netflix?
Yes,
Yeah,
watch on Netflix.
amazing how many people saw it on Netflix. Because it was out on everything else for 2 months. It was out on Amazon and iTunes and Google Play and, oh, what was the other one? I can't remember off the top of my head. But it was on every other platform. Anyway, so he said in the director's commentary on the iTunes version that when, and you probably remember this from the movie or briefly, that 12-year-old kid was got on the microphone and was asking me questions at the conference. And that's when, and I asked him how old he was. And that's when he said his tone had changed. And everybody involved in that movie, as far as producing, it changed, where it's like, okay, now this is getting out of hand. Meaning, if the kids are involved, the whole think of the children. And that's when he decided he was going to spin it in a certain direction. And, he was trying to be as objective, I think, as he could until that point. It's like, no, we have a responsibility to protect the children, which I think is utter BS. So, because it's not like we were recruiting, out there. They came to us. And so, yeah. Sorry. So that was a long-winded version of that's how the movie got made. I had nothing to do with the production of it. Only that the only part of the production I had it as I contacted some of the other people involved, and I said, "Hey, this guy's shooting a documentary. You want to talk to him?" And people were more than happy to do so. And so that's how it got made. And to this day, I know I'm rambling. To this day, I still consider it probably the biggest recruiting tool we have. Because I have sat in several audiences where people, it's 95% globalists, and when they're sitting down, they have questions, a lot of questions by the time they get to the end of it. And if it was just a flat earth propaganda piece, you wouldn't get that. So, anyway, there you
Yes, so it started off as they came to you
go.
almost to be to see your side of it, and then it spun into they're gonna kind of make flat earthers look stupid in a
Oh,
way.
they could have made it much much worse than that. Initially, again, it was supposed to be just about the people of flat Earth, the interesting people that are in flat Earth, like anything. It's like the interesting people that handle snakes or whatever. It seemed harmless, I'm sure. And then, but by the time he was done, the funny thing was, the ironic thing was, by the time he got to Raleigh, It had become so big. He realized how big it was, and at that point he had to finish the film, right? They had already tied up a lot of resource into it, so he had to finish the film. But he had shot so many, so he could only tweak it so much against us because of all the footage he had taken. He was trying to be objective. So oh no, it could have been way, way worse than what it was. People, if you want to see way worse, look at the National Geographic piece.
Oh, right. I saw that one
Yeah,
with the
they shot it with us for 3 days, 3 solid days, and they only released 10 minutes of it, and it was the weakest stuff that was there. They even cannibalized. There was a balloon experiment that they set up that completely failed on their part. We saw the balloons at 10 miles away on the beach, and they wouldn't even use it. They erased it. Of course, we've got it all on camera, which is just the recommendation I tell to anybody that's doing anything with the media, and that is, if you can, record it on your own in addition to what they're shooting, because the power of editing, it is very, you can do so much with editing, and we may get into that. So anyway.
Yeah, it's just as soon as I saw the trailer to Behind the Curve and I where it flashed the title sequence, have you ever wondered how someone can believe something flat out wrong?
Right.
I knew that this was it was gonna be a where it was gonna try to be anti flat earth peace
Yeah, it could, again,
somewhat,
go ahead.
but
Go ahead.
I was just wondering, because at the end when they show where the test sort of fails,
Right.
what do you say about that? Because I was wondering too if there were other tests they didn't put in that one as well.
Oh my God, yes. There we taught You gotta remember that we shot with them for 7 months off and on, and they boiled it down to 99 minutes. 7 months. There was so many monologues. I can't count the hours that I talked on camera with these guys, and Bob and Jaron. We all did. We all went on amazing rants about all sorts of stuff, and they all hit the cutting room floor because they were not going to show. They were not going to get our points across if they could help it. And the Jaron experiment, I chalk it up to the power of editing, which was, and Jaron will be the first one to jump on it. And same thing with Bob, which is, you can, it is as timeless as media, which is, if you can take things out of context, you can make people look, well, not necessarily terrible, but you can make it to where your point doesn't come across. The perfect example would be the the green button when I was at the Kennedy Space Center. And remember, I didn't do any experiments, so there was only so he was limited in what he could take shots at me, but there was that green button on the exhibit, which he didn't even do it deliberately. He At the end of any when you're shooting any sort of footage of anybody, you once the people leave the frame, leave the frame, you zoom in, and you stay on there because it's for editing. You shoot, I don't know, 30 seconds of extra footage. And so they all of a sudden came up with the idea. It's like, wait a minute, what if we show that Mark never hit the button? Of course I hit the button. It was a big shiny green button. Right, literally there's only one button in the whole thing when you sit down, and it wasn't working, which is why I jumped on the touch screen. But it wasn't a touch screen. So I'm just hitting the screen going, I got nothing. Nothing's happening. And it's like, okay, all you have to do is remove the green button. Voila. Mark misses the obvious, therefore Mark misses the globe, which is obvious. And that was that little dig. In fact, he even asked me at the premiere if it was okay that he did that. I said, yeah, sure. You want to take your shot, that's fine. Because he seemed really happy with the way that they edited it. And Bob and Jaron fell into that. The laser experiment, of course. Oh my God. Of course, okay, in Jaron's defense. And he was the first one to tell me this. He goes, I will never do an experiment again where I do it live the first time on camera. I go, yeah, that's pretty smart. Don't ever do it. Don't ever assume. We all do. The same thing with the salt and sea experiment. That worked in our favor, which was the debunker group that was down there with National Geographic. They had never tried this experiment either. They were doing it live for the first time on camera, and they failed in our favor. And they cut that scene out. So anyone that has any doubt in Jaron, I will just defer to the Lake Balaton experiment in Hungary, which we told them about. We had all the documentation. We gave them all the video. They had plenty of time to show it, and they didn't show any of it, which was us shooting. I wasn't there. It was Karen B and the FE core team. 40 kilometers, military grade laser. Everything was documented to the hilt. Guinness Book of World Records was there to verify the whole thing. Didn't even, you know, the words never even entered the film. Any good experiments that we had, and we had a bunch, they weren't going to show it. And any experiments that had problems for whatever reason, they weren't going to, you know, they were going to maximize those. Like, for real quick example, I know I'm rambling a little bit, which is the Jaren's first experiment. You got to remember, there were two different experiments. They flew up twice. And the first one, he melted the beam focuser, the lens, the laser condenser. He melted it because he had it on too long. Didn't talk about it. Just said, oh, he's got problems. They weren't going to go into it, you know, even though they talked about it at length, which is why Jaren was so upset that that they wouldn't release. And again, it was just naive on Jaren's part, where he asked them for all, you know, any of the extra footage so that he could put it on his YouTube channel and say, look, I had problems with this and here's why. And they sold it all, because a lot of people don't know, when you sell a documentary to somebody, you know, what you see on screen is 100 minutes of documentary, but you have hours and hours and hours, if not days, of footage. Well, they usually buy all that as well. So they buy all the stuff that that was on the cutting room floor, which is, of course, all digital now. So who knows? Maybe they'll even make a second one after this. They've got enough to make another one.
Right. Have you ever thought to get together with some other people and make one from completely controlled by flat earthers?
Oh, so sure. They're in the works right now. I've got problem with that. But at the same time, this was kind of a blessing in disguise. And I predicted this. I mean, if you hear any of my stuff, I said, look, flat earthers are going to hate it. But globalists are, but it's going to recruit so many people that it won't matter. But here's the problem with that. This movie, for example, people don't know about how the film festival stuff works. When you make a movie, right, and you don't have a distributor, you know, let's say you just shot a movie. Well, how do you get it out there? You submit it to film festivals, and like the Toronto Film Festival had 3,000 submissions, right? Out of those, only 100 were chosen. And we were one of those. And then out of those, you know, they're the ones that make like the top 10, forget about the awards, the top 10 must watch movies, you know, in case you missed it, films you should, you know, should check out. We were always making those lists. That wouldn't have happened if it was a Flat Earth propaganda piece, you know, meaning it was like a Flat Earth cheerleading movie. Here's why. Literally, you know, because after film festivals, there's a Q&A where the director goes up on stage with producers and the audience asks them questions. Sometimes it's media, sometimes it's not. Almost always, the first question they ask them is, are you flat earthers? They ask the director that. And immediately they would say no, and there would be this big sigh of relief. It's like, oh, okay, now we can talk to them like real people. Because had they gone up there and said, are you a flat earther? Well, then the question's just... The whole tone of the room changes, and I know this because I was there. And they don't even want to talk to the producers anymore. When we did the Toronto thing, I was in the audience, and the director said, oh, you know, I'm going to announce you after the movie. I go, I don't think it's a good idea. Oh, no, it'll be fine, totally be fine. And he was absolutely wrong. Where as soon as they found out that Patricia and I were in the theater, they didn't want to talk to the director anymore. People just wanted, you know, they had all these Flat Earth questions. So anyway, the Flat Earth cheerleading movies, they're in the works right now. Will they be successful? I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah, but I would think those ones might only be watched by people that are already flat earthers.
Yeah, then. It really depends, because the reason why, again, Daniel did what he did, but at the same time, you get him and you watched it. I mean, because there was a psychiatrist, because there was several scientists and an astronaut and so on and so on, it let the, and even the title, you know, Behind the Curve, it's not exactly the most flattering title in the world. It draws people in. It makes a globalist feel safe when they go in. It's like, oh, we get to make fun of flat earthers. Okay. And you'd be amazed at the people that I was sitting next to them. You know, the first 20, 30 minutes, if you're a globalist, you're watching this, you don't think it's real. You think it's some sort of piece of docu-fiction. In fact, I'll tell you a quick story. There was a an editor in LA who was shown this without any context whatsoever. He didn't know anything about the flat earth community. And at the end, when it was done, he was just floored. And he said to the production team at Delta V, he said, "Wow, that's what sort of budget did you guys have? This is amazing." And they said, "What are you talking about?" It's like, where did you get all these actors? They played it so real, like it was a thing.
Oh, he
And
thought it was a
yeah,
mockumentary.
he did. Well, not a mockumentary, a piece of docufiction.
Oh, docufiction.
Mockumentary, you know it's fake, right? Docufiction, you can't tell if it's real or not.
Okay, I see.
And he completely thought it. And when they told him, he goes, "What do you mean that Raleigh conference that actually happened? That was a real, a real event." It's like, yeah, man, it was a real event. So it sucks you in. I've seen so many. I mean, ever since the Netflix release, the media has been, well, as you can imagine, just been jumping all over this. And so many globalists have been, like, Jaron was contacted from by high school friends that haven't talked to him in years. So, Patricia's social media blew up. Chris Pontius can't even begin to fill the orders that he's getting for his freaking models. Nathan Thompson, his Facebook group is just blown up. It's crazy, but that's because, again, it asks questions. It's a Trojan horse. Again, yeah, flat earthers aren't going to find any love in it because, every time you see a scientist or a psychiatrist on screen saying, "Well, those flat earthers, they're just misinformed," it drives you insane. But they did it with a smile, which also I got to add, is the reason why they made Matt Boylan the villain, because he was the only guy that was actually angry during the entire thing, which is weird because we're on the same team anyway. So, sorry, go ahead.
I didn't understand when there was the it was like they were trying to take shots, with the NASA, the astronaut, where he goes, "Last time I heard about Flat Earth, I was in space."
Yep, and that was
And
very deliberate. Very, very deliberate. In fact, they told me that they only had like 15 minutes with him, if that. From setup to close. And when I heard him say that line, the first time I heard about Flat Earth, I think I was in space, which is an interesting way to say it, because what do you mean you think you were in space? Weren't you, or were you? And but he came there just for that line, because that's your trailer line. That's a great line. It's like, oh, here's an astronaut. You immediately go on the offensive and try to discredit flat earthers. And they said they were lucky to get him. The question is, why was the astronaut talking to them in the first place? How, why would he even agree to this? I mean, he's a freaking retired colonel in the United States military that's going around doing a book tour. Why is he talking about, why is he even responding to flat earth? And that's because we won't go away. We just keep getting bigger and bigger.
And I heard, I don't know if you've ever heard Eddie Bravo talk about Flat
Oh,
Earth.
of course.
And I saw, I think it was just the other day, he said if the astronauts want to really end the argument for good, he said they would have an uncut GoPro footage of them going up, docking at the ISS,
Yeah.
and looking down at the Earth, all uncut, all one clip. He said, but they won't do it.
Yeah, and that's my line, by the way. I mean, because
Oh,
people have
that's where
been
he got it.
people have been asking me. I don't mind. No, you'd be amazed how much credit I don't get. Because, oh, you're a leader, flat earth. No, I'm not. I'm just a guy. But I will say this: I am quotable, and I come up with some pretty clever ideas. And yeah, taking a 4K camera and putting it on some sort of rocket and just not editing the footage. People, remember what I said earlier: the power of editing is extreme. What you can do. Because it always comes down to that. You see, all you need, if all of a sudden, it's a continuous shot, and then you immediately the first edit cut, it's like, okay, because you remember, anything can happen during that cut, which means, okay, it's probably not live at that point, and it's probably, who knows what they're doing behind the scenes during every cut. And if you do like five cuts in an hour, all right, well, then the whole thing's screwed up. And if you do five cuts in a minute, that means you're dealing with something else, like, the ISS cuts, all the edits that happen in that. And I don't even get into the ISS. That's a whole nother thing. But yeah, Eddie Bravo is absolutely right. A 4K camera on any sort of vehicle that goes from the ground to the space station. Why don't we see any decent 4K footage docking? of anybody docking. Why don't we have any 4K footage of an astronaut getting to an airlock, hitting the pressure thing, and then walking out of the airlock? I mean, we've been doing this for decades now. But if you're going to go down that road, of course, you know, the biggest one is, you know, just the image. Why was the first blue marble shot taken in 1972 and not in the 60s? And then why was the second blue marble shot not taken until 2015? It's 43 right. years. That's ridiculous. I mean, in technology terms, that's might as well be infinity. You know, that's most of the 70s, all of the 80s, all of the 90s, all of 2000 to 2010, and halfway to now. No blue marble shots, no shots of the Earth. You're milking one image. It's ridiculous. It's incredible.
And I don't know, much about this entirely, because I just started looking into this about 8 months ago.
Eight months isn't bad. I'd be a little more concerned if it was 2 months. 8 months, you're okay.
Right.
You're not bad.
I still feel fairly new with still learning new things all the time. And I saw, let me see, what was it? I watched the Flat Earth Man music videos.
Oh, yeah. I bought his album just recently. And
I see his stuff and because I didn't know at first if he was serious or not with, because the first one I watched was No Photographs of Earth.
Yeah.
And I couldn't tell whether or not he was serious at first. And I started watching his other videos.
Yeah.
And I saw the where Logan Paul was at one of the Flat Earth conferences.
Yes. Denver. Yeah.
Was he serious, do you think? Or was that for...
Okay. I'll tell you. His motivation is strictly, and I'm not going to bash on him too much, because if you know anything, you knew that I walked out of the Denver conference because of him.
Oh, okay.
Because he was kept a complete secret from everyone, literally up until like 12 hours before we went live, and I was in complete denial. There's no way it could be Logan Paul. Logan Paul's one of the most horrible people on the internet. He's just terrible. I mean, I just don't, I'm sorry. I don't like people that play practical jokes, and I certainly don't like it when they get paid for it, because that just encourages really bad behavior. I mean, I could barely stand Johnny Knoxville with the Jackass team years ago, and that's really what it is. It's Jackass on the internet now. That's all it is. But his goal is hits, and there was a video, one of the guys that he watches on a regular basis to like compare, see what he can do, is Shane Dawson. And if you know who Shane Dawson is, you know, he's got millions of hits, but his audience is way more devoted. Mm-hmm. And I completely get that. And Logan Paul doesn't understand it. It's like, why is Shane Dawson get all the attention and not me, you know, compared to Shane? And it's like, well, I don't know, because Shane had a tragically gay, broken childhood. And, you know, he wears his soul on his sleeve, and kids respect that. You know, he's fairly authentic with what he does. I mean, he's a really honest, really sensitive guy. And Logan wanted to kind of feel that out. And Shane made a Flat Earth video, and it's now the number one Flat Earth video on the internet. Mm-hmm. Right? It's got...
Yep. I saw that one, and then he spins it into... the simulation theory, at some point, which I didn't understand at all.
Well, that's a whole other topic if you want to go down that road, and that is, but I'll mention it real quick. And I don't like telling it to people, because the average person on the street, unless you know software development and physics and some math, you're not going to get it. But the short version is this, which is, if it's flat and it's enclosed, you know, like a snow globe, then it's probably also simulated, because that's how we build simulations. There are some things out there, like the thing that I try, again, I don't want to get into it too much, which is when you play video games, right? You're a young guy, play video games.
I do.
Oh, perfect. Okay. You know full well that there are limits to the game grid. So when you're walking out, whatever, I don't know what game you play, but when you're walking out somewhere and you look off in the distance and you see a mountain, right? And you know that character will never, ever go to the other side of that mountain, because, you know, it's just part of the game. It's a limit to the to the game. Does the programmer build the other side of the mountain? No, they don't. They don't build anything past that. They don't pat. In fact, they don't build past anything that you can see because it's just a waste of computer power, right? And the weird part is that when we do electron gun experiments now, and we've been doing this for the last 20 years, we see the same thing here in the world that we're living and breathing in. And every scientist has this in the back of their head if they know the double slit experiment. It's like, okay, why is the same thing that's happening in the video game world happening here?
Mm-hmm.
And, well, you know, there's really only one answer to it. But anyway, so that's what we'll get into. But I'm sorry, let me finish the Logan Paul thing. So Logan comes to the conference, and he was really just fishing for footage for ratings. That's all he was doing. Mm-hmm. You know, he's had plenty of chances to, I mean, heck, that was in November. It's March. And he's right. Never officially come out of the Flat Earth closet. In fact, he didn't even understand the footage that he shot to the point where he's now subcontracting out the editing to where when it finally does come out, and I imagine it'll come out maybe this month, it won't be his. It'll be somebody else's. It'll be somebody else that'll be doing the editing because, a quick analogy would be like if you had a dumb jock, no offense to dumb jocks, but a lot of them are dumb. If you had a dumb jock was told, okay, you got to hang out with the math club for an afternoon and then write a book report on it. He could hang out with the math club for a month. It's not going to make a difference. He's going to come back. He's like, how does he write a book report? He can't do it. And he can talk to all his jock friends and be like, dude, I have no idea. So he basically has to hire geeks to write the book report for him. And that is what Logan is doing right now. So anyway.
Well, then do you think it will be a serious film if he's not going to be making it entirely?
Well, that's an excellent point. That's an excellent question, which was if he was editing it entirely because he only knows jokes, he only knows pranks, mm-hmm. it would not be a serious piece. It would be tongue-in-cheek the entire time. But because he's got some geeks looking at it, I don't think it will be as bad. The problem they're going to have is that every scene he's in, he's just clowning around. So at that point, you're going to have, which is probably why it's being delayed, because I'm sure the first draft they threw at him, he's like, hey, why am I not in this more? It's like, because you're never serious whenever you're on camera. And you want to make a serious piece like Shane Dawson's was. I mean, Shane did it on his own. He didn't even call any of us until mm-hmm. later. Then Shane Dawson's group contacted us, and we flew down there and shot a thing with his brother. But he did it on his own. Whereas Logan, I will give him credit that he actually went to Denver to the conference and paid for all the tickets. But I don't know. I don't think it's going to be that serious. If it is, hey, great, fantastic. I just don't know how. If I was an editor and I was looking at Logan's footage, I would just cut him out of the film entirely, right. Just have him narrate it, and that would then he might be able to do something. But everybody on the internet knows Logan. He's never made a serious piece in his life. So now after whatever 5 years he's been doing this, now he's going to make a serious piece. I don't know. Just the confidence isn't high.
Yeah, I'm curious. I'll watch it. It's just it was supposedly gonna come out in January.
Yep.
Then February.
Yep.
It's March. It still is not here.
Yeah. I mean, he might. I mean, again, it if it comes out and it's a serious piece, it'll generate hits. Even if it's an attack piece, because there's a whole mm-hmm. bunch of those out there. I mean, there's giant channels. Look at freaking PewDiePie. Regardless of mm-hmm. how many actual subs he has. It still generated a lot of hits. So, the old saying, which is wrong, is any publicity is good publicity. And that's not really true. The original saying is even bad publicity is free.
Right.
And it's like, yeah, I mean, even the National Geographic piece. I mean, hey, a million hits, in fact, CBS, for example, they ran, they were down there at the same time Nat Geo was, and they shot some footage and Patricia Steer was featured in. And it got a million hits, and they pulled it. They yanked it off of YouTube voluntarily because they were catching so much backlash, because it was fairly neutral. So we'll take anything. What I just don't want, and again, I'm not the leader, but what I don't want and what I will fight against is bad celebrities. Plain and simple. I mean, we all know there's good and bad celebs out there. You know, there's ones that get in trouble and like anything, and there's some that don't. and he's a bad celeb. So you don't what you don't
Right.
want is someone like him all of a sudden going on talk shows or wherever he goes, not that he will, and start saying, trying to explain flat Earth to people, because that would go terrible. Last thing on this, which would be rapper B.O.B. You remember him?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So he got into it. And hey, Grammy nominated, fantastic. He's talented, no question. Terrible in interviews. If you ever watch him get interviewed, he's awful. And when he talks about, well, flat Earth, is even worse. And so it's like you wouldn't want flat, B.O.B. And then thank God he realized, like, yeah, I can't really talk about this, because he just can't. He just doesn't. Whatever. He can't come up with the answers fast enough. So that's B.O.B., right? Logan Paul is freaking Shakespeare compared to B.O.B. No, I'm
Right.
sorry. No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Reverse that. Stop that. Reverse that. B.O.B. is infinite. Wow, I completely screwed that up. B.O.B. is infinitely better at interviews. And if you have any doubt, just look up, anyone listening, look up the Daily Beast interview, where they interviewed him right outside the front doors of that Denver conference. And they were trying to ask him serious questions. He couldn't even form sentences. It's like, wow, it's amazing. Give an eighth grader millions of dollars and see what happens. Well, there you go.
And I saw, I think I heard this, because I was watching a lot of Eddie Bravo talking about it on the Joe Rogan podcast, how they're now censoring flat Earth videos on YouTube.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
I was just gonna say I didn't know if that was true or not because I still, it doesn't seem like, have you noticed getting any less views or anything from that
No,
or?
no. It's interesting because YouTube's in a tough position. If you remember last year, you've been in this 8 months, so you would have caught some of this. When Google, who owns YouTube, had to talk to the United States government about the issue of fake news and bad news that's on the internet. And of course, one of the leading, the one they focused on was flat Earth, which was weird. And so Google had to figure out something because they were, well, what was happening was, is we're kind of systemic, meaning we generate so much interest that it just keeps looping on itself. Meaning, there was a guy that worked as a programmer for Google, and he came out after he worked for them, and they asked him why things are recommended on the sidebar. What initiates that? And he says, well, if the average flat earther watches 20 flat earth videos in a row, what do you think happens? What do you think we're going to recommend? And what he was saying was there were so many people, because when you get into flat earth, I mean, it's just you just binge watch immediately. You're just watching for like 2 weeks straight. That it was starting to clog the search engines. And nobody, and we were getting recommended for stuff regardless. So it's like you type in JFK, oh, here's some flat earth videos for you. Oh, Pearl Harbor, flat earth, potato salad, flat earth. It just kept showing up to where eventually there was a lot enough people complaining that they didn't say they were going to censor it. They just said we're going to recommend it less.
Okay, I see.
And it's fine. I actually, at that point, it doesn't really matter because we had already had. Remember, they were helping us, and I don't want, people said, oh, Google's evil. It's like, no. Google was helping us for at least 3 years straight. We were getting recommended all the time, not just in YouTube. We were also getting recommended in Google, and we still are in Google to a certain degree. But it's so prevalent out there that now they can say, oh no, we're doing something about it, and they're not really doing that much about it. I mean, we still the flat earth topic makes Google a lot of money, because you don't forget that YouTube is not just some internet thing. It is the largest television network in the world now, with thousands of lifetimes worth of content for just about literally anything you could think of. So they're not censoring it. Now you'll know when that actually happens, because when channels go down, or if all of a sudden, if you were the next stage of censoring Flat Earth would be if all of a sudden they did a headline and they said we're going to demonetize Flat Earth, which they have not done.
Okay. Well,
At
that's a good sign. I didn't know how far it had
no
gotten
no
or
no
if it
not
was even
nope
true or not.
No, I mean, that is the first step, and people think it's a slippery slope. You're absolutely right for asking, in that, if they're not recommending it as much, isn't that a form of censorship? It's like, if it was a government-run thing, yeah, maybe, but it's a private company. I mean, technically, it's no different than saying in a restaurant, you know, no shirt, no shoes, no service type of thing. You know, you can get kicked out of a restaurant for no reason at all. You know, you walk in there and you have no legal recourse. It's like they can just say, sorry, you know, we have the right to refuse service. Anyway.
Okay, then explain to me, because I don't quite understand. People say the Flat Earth Society is actually different. They say that one's controlled opposition.
Yeah, and I unfortunately will have to take the credit for that because I was the one. I'm not going to say it's a rumor. I'm not. When I first got in, because I joined back in 2014, I joined the Flat Earth Society because I wanted to know. It's like, okay, these guys probably know what's going on. Maybe I should join them. And I realized that they, for whatever reason, were not really engaged in Flat Earth. I call them, what I like to call them now is Flat Earth 1.0, which is they're the old guard of Flat Earth. They've been around for a long, long time. And then Flat Earth 2.0 came around, which is the social media groups, you know, all the YouTube channels and all the websites and all that. So the reason why I told people, I'm going, look, really don't want to go to the Flat Earth Society. And then it kind of spiraled into, okay, they're a government operation. I don't think I ever said they were a government operation in the clues, but I said, don't go to them because it's going to be a waste of your time. And the reason why I said that was there were trolls there, dedicated trolls that had thousands and thousands of posts. And it was like they were running the velvet rope for Flat Earth out there. And they were saying the same thing all the time. It's like, it's not real. It's not serious. Don't even look here. Go away. It's not real. So, I mean, just over and over and over. And I'm going, wow, that's pretty impressive. Because, you know, if you're a troll, if you're just one of those evil people that want to instigate and create havoc and do all these awful things, you could, there is no more fertile ground than YouTube, right? That's where you hang out. You can want to make people cry. You can make people cry all day long on YouTube if you're a troll. So why are you hanging out all day at this little club out in the middle of nowhere in the internet that's only got like 500 people out there at the time? Why would you do that? Why? And on top of that, why would the admins of that website allow that to happen? That's what blew me away. It's like, why is so at worst case scenario, they might be a government operation. I can't confirm or deny that. But at the very least, they are apathetic. Meaning they just don't care what happens to their forums. And okay, well, then you're a waste of my time. I mean, seriously, if the first thing you see when you walk in the door at the Flyer Society is trolls that are telling you straight up, it's like, nope, they're not real, and nobody's countering that, then yeah, nobody should go there. And I said that in a little, I don't know, what, 30 seconds, 30, not even 60 seconds in my early Flat Earth clues. And which is funny because now people are coming back to me. It's like, wow, the grapevines. Oh, sorry, I gotta hang up on this guy. When people, sorry, when people come to me now and say, oh, you joined the Flat Earth Society, you must be a shill. And it's like, no, do you even remember? That shows you how long we've gone. It's like, do you remember who told you the Flat Earth Society was bad in the first place? It was me. So you can't come
I
back
see.
and use that on me. I was the one that told you in the first place. It's like this big, like the grapevine went in a complete circle and came back around at me. And so that part's a little frustrating, but whatever. That's fine.
Well, I heard they put out real points, and then they also put out easily points that can be easily debunked on
Well,
purpose.
okay, and part
Is
of that's
that true or
rumor, by the
not?
way. The point that got them in trouble more than anything was that you could simulate gravity, and yes, technically it's correct, but it's a horrible, the model just ticks people off, is that gravity is created by a G force, an upward G force. So that we're this flat disk flying upwards in space at whatever the speed is per second, which generates a G force. And it's like, yeah, that would work, but then you're going into the whole that one, we're in space, and two, okay, how does that work with density and buoyancy, and how does that work with a, I mean, yeah, it could work with a dome, but yeah, it's one of those things that media likes latching onto. That's the one that really gets people more than more, I hear that more often than anything else. And it's like, no, the average, in fact, I find me anyone in the Flat Earth 2.0 community that believes in the upward G-force model that the Flat Earth Society puts out. I don't know anybody.
Because I've watched a lot of the Flat Earth debunking videos, and it seems like most of their arguments are based on a snuck premise of what we don't actually believe, but they use the false theory.
Yep. Yep. Well, yeah, why wouldn't you? You're gonna go after the weakest one. So yeah, why not? Because it's also visually so easy to poke fun of, because it looks silly. I mean, yeah, technically it would work. It's no different than flying a plane, you know, and pulling on the stick and going straight up. Yes, it will generate a G-force. And which means, okay, well, what if the whole thing was a giant spacecraft? It's like, yeah, I guess. But then you're delving into stuff that the media, like, you know, they can point and laugh at easier than others.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I started watching Matt Long's channel from Woke Town. I actually saw you on it yesterday.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I was just on
that podcast. I listened to that one.
Yeah.
So I started to watch his videos. I never saw the where he talks about biblical cosmology, and from his IGTV series, the 3 5-minute episodes.
Okay.
So I understand from the firmament perspective how the flat earth would work, but explain what the infinite plane society is exactly. Okay. I'm not.
No, it's all right.
I
it's
can't
right.
wrap my head around that.
No, sure you can. It hasn't been phrased to you in a certain way. Okay. So if the world was a snow globe, right, sitting on a desk somewhere, let's just say, I don't know, an advanced civilization, God's desk, who knows, right? Okay. A snow globe sitting on a desk, and you took off the dome. What do you have? Well, now you have a flat earth map that's sitting on a desk that stretches out God knows how far in all directions. That's what the infinite plane is. Meaning, and there still may be an infinite plane outside the dome. We don't know. But that's where, so, and I said this in the documentary, which is like, you know, roughly 70% of the community believes in some sort of dome and 30% doesn't. And what I found is that the people that don't usually are the people that don't like being, they don't like the whole idea of confinement, which was part of my clues anyway. You know, some people just don't, I have had many emails where people say, oh, you know, the whole dome thing makes me feel claustrophobic. I'm going, look, it's still a really, really big place. You know, it's an old Stephen Wright joke, which is, it's a small world, but I wouldn't want to paint it. Right, it's huge. It's really, really a big place. But when you're told that you're in this endless universe, then all of a sudden, oh no, you're in a one room apartment. Yeah, people can freak out, and so some people don't like it. But that's all it is. It's either dome versus no dome. And if it's no dome, you run into the whole gravity versus atmosphere thing, which is, you know, okay, if there's no dome, then how do we have atmospheric pressure? Meaning pressure needs a container. So therefore, it's the same argument as the globe. So there's nowhere they can go. But it's okay. Again, the majority believe in the dome anyway. So infinite plane, hey, great. If it's an infinite plane, I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. Either way, it's still flat.
I see. It's just for me, it's no dome would mean no firmament.
Yeah.
So, but the whole reason I really started believing it was because I started looking at the moon landings being fake. That's what I never really got into conspiracies until recently. And I started looking at the moon landings being faked because for the longest time, my brother was crazy into it. He still doesn't believe the flat earth. He looks into all these other conspiracies though.
Right.
So I looked into that, and then I ran across a flat earth video that said something biblical proofs. So then I got on to Google and I started looking up Bible verses about flat earth. So that's what I can't understand, is if it's not from a biblical point of view, then I don't know. I'm not phrasing it right.
No, it's okay. No, I get it. And you know, the one I always recommend people to go to would be Rob Skiba's, which, cause he was the one that tore into it first. And he's got a website called testingtheglobe.com, which goes through just about every chapter and verse you can think of. Literally, and there's only one verse that even begins to touch on a globe model, which is Isaiah 40:22, which is he who sitteth upon the circle of the earth. And as everybody knows, like circle, you know, at that point we're talking about words here. Circle is not globe, circle is not ball, circle is not sphere. Circle can be a dinner plate, it can be a dining room table, it can be a hubcap, it can be a roulette table. You know, it can be all sorts of things. It could be a freaking pizza, right? Circle is a circle. So if every other Bible verse talks the about the world being flat, stationary, immovable, firmament, the Tower of Babel, the Star of Joshua, so on and so on and so on, then it's obviously a flat earth book. And I know some people don't like hearing that, but it's true. And you probably got into it because of that. So the question is, how do people, yeah, you're right. From a biblical standpoint, infinite plane doesn't do anything. There's there's no, especially because, you know, Genesis was the book that talked about the firmament. Not only that, but Psalms and a bunch of others, they talk about the firmament. So why wouldn't there be a firmament? And but so the bigger question is, the people that believe in infinite plane, are they also not going along with the Bible? That could very, very possible. In fact, that'd be an interesting social graph to plot. Because remember, I don't know the numbers exactly, but at least half of the flat earth community are, at least in the United States, are strong Christians. And it's mostly because, you know, find me somewhere in the Bible other than Isaiah 40:22 that talks about how the world works.
Mm-hmm. And I never questioned any of it. Because whenever I was in high school, I'm graduated now.
Yeah.
Whenever I was in high school, I remember junior year, every single week for the biology class, we would have to look up an article about space and bring it to the teacher. And that was one of our weekly grades.
Really?
So I remember, yes. And I remember, this is a small town in Oklahoma.
Yeah.
And I remember just, I was actually like getting interested in learning about all this stuff. And I would, you know, bring in papers about other planets that look like Earth and things like that. And we'd have to read them to the class. So that was a big part of.
Wow.
Of my high school is I was actually getting interested in space, and I never really thought about, wait, this contradicts everything
right
that I've learned from the Bible since I was little, because I already, you know, obviously I never believed in evolution,
right?
But I was watching Matt Long's channel, and he said, well, if the Big Bang happened, then what was the sun, what was the earth revolving around for 3 days, because the sun wasn't created till three or four.
Oh, yeah.
So that throws it out the window from, if you believe in the Bible, from that first, from the start, really.
Right. Oh, you know, you're absolutely right. And it is one of the, as you know, one of the giant, if not the biggest debate in our civilization, which is, okay, is religion right or is astronomy right? Because you cannot have it both ways. And for the last, well, at least last 100 years, in fact, actually only the last 50 years, science has been, you know, because of social media, because of the internet, because of all the forms of media, television and radio and you name it, science has taken a huge lead. But that apparently, you know, things tend to balance out. And that's, I think, where we are now. Whereas, yeah, even when I was a kid, I remember, you know, I thinking, wait a minute. If I lived on Mars, would the Bible rules still apply to me? Because the Bible is written for our civilization, not Mars. And let's say I was, you know, or even not Mars. It's like, well, no, the whole solar system. It's like, well, outside the solar system, there's, yeah, huge and dead. Don't get me into evolution and the Big Bang Theory and carbon dating and, oh, I don't know, dark matter and dark energy and all that fun stuff. They've got huge, huge problems. But what science, here's the difference. Science fell into the same boat that some religions do, which is they took liberties. So remember, science isn't supposed to take leaps of faith, and they did. They jumped from science to scientism, And if anyone doesn't know what I'm talking about there, what I mean is things that can't be tested, which we are told are law. So if you want to tell me what the boiling temperature of water is at sea level, fine. I could test that right now. You want to tell me what the core of the Earth looks like? No. You haven't even been close to the core of the Earth. Not even the tiniest fraction, a fraction of 1%. And you're telling us what all the whole core of the Earth looks like, and the core of Jupiter and Saturn, bodies you haven't even been to. You're telling us what the core looks like, based on what? And then they just go from there. Let me end this part on this, which is there's a thing that Tesla said, Nikola Tesla, which I loved, which he and I'm going to butcher it a little bit, but to paraphrase. He said that science basically just builds equations on top of each other without checking the foundation, to where when you get up to a certain level, the equations are meaningless because everybody assumes that everybody below them is right. And if any stage of that tower of equations is wrong, then the whole thing's wrong. And but they don't go that route. They say, no, it's absolutely right. And the last thing I'll say on that is this, Neil deGrasse Tyson's statement, which is one of the most arrogant things I've ever heard uttered, which is science is right whether or not you believe in it. That's like, wow, that is such a broad statement. It's like, no, it's not. But that statement shows you where their head's at. It's like you put on the lab coat, you rubber stamp it, it's science, it's real. And it's like, okay, because you've been wrong about a lot of things, lots. Anyway.
And I just remember we would watch the cosmos with him in it in school, and then we would get our tests and it would say, how old is the Earth? And me and my friend, we'd write 6,000 years old, and then we'd have to go to the teacher, talk to her, and she goes, I understand, you're seeing it from a biblical perspective. We're asking about the video, and we would purposely try to be difficult with things like that to see what they would do. And it was a lot of stuff like that in my high school of get a test and then we would answer it one way, but they can't, I don't, we never actually failed it because of it. They would, I don't know if they
Oh
can.
no, they're not allowed. I mean, there is, even though we have separation of church and state, religious freedom is still a very big thing in this country. And no, it was good. No, that's I'm that's that warms my heart that you would actually take that stand. And you wouldn't be alone. There's a lot of people out there that do that. For me, I've had to take it a, I tried to live a quiet life for quite a some time. And now I realize it's like, okay, the world isn't getting any better. I got to do something. And apparently this is what I've been shoulder tapped to do. So anyway, what else you got?
I didn't even take science my senior year because I didn't have to.
Nice. Good
Got
for
out of
you.
that as soon as I could, and
Good for you.
so
Nice.
I don't really know what else there really is
To ask?
to
Any,
ask.
well, I don't know, you got any personal questions? You got any little nuggets that just were bugging you? Any little nagging things? You can ask about anything or anyone. I'll be as candid as I can.
Let's see, it's mainly I'm trying to, because when I tell my friends about this, I have maybe two friends that kinda can see my point of view, and then all my other friends, laugh, think it's stupid.
That's just
They don't
peer.
even think I'm serious about it.
That's peer pressure more than anything. The people, it's a line from Men in Black that I gotta use. It's like a person is smart, but people are dumb, dangerous, and panicky. And peer pressure is a powerful thing, especially when you're younger. It's like because everyone wants to be part of the crowd. They don't want to stick out. Conformity is a very, very strong thing in this world. And when people go out outside, the ones that tend to, if you have enough conviction, and it sounds like you do, you're going to be fine. If you're trying to convince, in fact, don't, what I try to tell people is don't try to convince your friends. All you have to do is put the seed in their head and let it go. It's like lighting the fuse and walking away, because is once they just get an inkling of it in their head, once they start questioning it themselves, they're stuck. like everybody else. You know, me, remember, I hated Flat Earth, hated it. I said, I can disprove this thing in 3 days. And I didn't, I wasn't even going around friends. There wasn't even peer pressure. It's like, whatever, I can totally torch this thing. And then there, all of a sudden I started making the, I created a YouTube channel and made, you know, started making videos on it. Doing it with your friends, you look for openings when you can, but you'll know who you got. Here's the tip. You want to know who's on the path already? They'll come back to you, even if they're angry at you or they're making fun of you. If they're asking questions while they're making fun, it's already in their head. So if they're laughing and saying, dude, what about the space shuttle? Dude, what about the moon? Dude, what about gravity? If that's our, if those are the questions, you've already you've already done half the battle.
Yep. And I guess the next thing would be because I want to, you know, start doing a Flat Earth YouTube channel.
Yeah.
I'm hoping to, you know, upload part of this.
Sure.
To it. But I wouldn't know maybe what route to go because there's so many Flat Earth channels already, and I just don't want to be doing, you know, the same exact thing.
The first thing I would do, if you don't mind me giving you some recommendations here, is first thing you do is tell your story. Mm-hmm. That's how you open. That's how you get in with, be as transparent as you can. There was a British woman that had a, you know, channel. It's not that huge, but she came out and just said, hey, look, my Flat Earth, I've seen it too many times, you know, and title it whatever speaks to you. My Flat Earth story, my Flat Earth awakening, my Flat Earth truth, how I got into Flat Earth. People want to know how other people got into it. The meetups, if there's a meetup anywhere near you that's coming down, you know, go to it, talk to people. You'd be amazed how fun it is sitting around a room of people that are absolutely on board with the same thing you are. I mean, there's a reason why the conference was as popular as it is and why we have so many conferences this year. But yeah, starting a channel, your first video should be how I got into Flat Earth. And if you do this, and you know, probably know what I'm going to say next, be ready. Because, yeah, there'll be some love from the Flat Earth community. In fact, write me and tell me if you end up doing it, I will absolutely promote your video and say, hey, look, you know, sub to this guy. I will sub to it in 2 seconds. but be ready because, you know, if you have any doubt, read through some of the comment sections on other people's videos that are there in the community. It is not necessarily brutal, but it is... you know, the resistance is high because people just don't like it's the only conspiracy you can't run away from. Every other conspiracy you don't want to look at JFK or Pearl Harbor or 9/11 or any of that stuff. You don't have to. Nobody does. But if somebody all of a sudden brings up Flat Earth, you can't walk away from that easy because it's like, oh yeah, by the way, the world isn't what you think it is. And that's Matrix stuff right there. And that freaks people out. So if you do it, short version of this is don't get frustrated by, in fact, you know what I do, and you probably heard me say this before. I don't even read the comments most of the time because I know what's in there. I mean, it's, and I know that it's just trolls because the trolls don't email me directly to this day. I mean, I put my email address, my phone number and home address, everything out there on the internet, and 99%. There's no exaggeration. 99% of the emails I get, and I get a lot of them, are either questioning or they're kind. Very few trolls will email you directly. That's the litmus test. That's how I know this thing's going to keep going. You know, anonymous people just say, you're an idiot, you're a moron, blah, blah. Yeah, come on. That's easy. And plus, as you know, let me end it on this. As you know, haters going to hate because... on any video, seriously, you could make a freaking video right now, a beautiful sunny meadow with a kitten chasing a puppy and a butterfly chasing them, right? Mm-hmm. Nothing wrong with this video at all, right? And within 100 views, you're going to have somebody come in there, thumbs down, saying, this is effing gay. You know, I hate you. And then it just goes downhill from there. And people with painful lives, they've got to send their pain somewhere. So just short version, don't take it personally. There you go.
Okay. Yes, because I started putting some ideas out for the whole like why I became a flat earther video.
Yeah.
So I still need to expand on that, write more ideas down, and then get it made.
Right.
But I will email you when
Yeah.
I officially.
Keep it simple and don't remember what I said in the beginning. The power of editing works also in your favor. Don't be afraid to chop out stuff. You know, it's like, it doesn't take that long and it really, really helps. Chop out the stuff that's like, eh, I don't like what I said there. Or, I mean, a lot of kids do it anyway, but there's a bunch of people that still don't. They just hit the play button or the record button and just go. And it's like, go off and get a sandwich, come back. It's like, no, just freaking say what you want to say. Keep it concise and go from there.
Okay.
Hey,
Well, I
if you don't mind me
appreciate you.
asking
Oh yeah.
before we break this up, because I never did this. How old are you anyway?
I'm 18.
Right on. Good for you.
Graduated May 2018.
Nice.
Then I, didn't want to go to college,
Hey, you know
but
what? You wouldn't be alone nowadays.
I'm about to in a couple of months in July, I'm about to start at a tech school actually.
Good for you. Seriously, the university system has gotten out of hand. I never would have thought that they would have just kept jacking up the fees. I mean, to where if you're going to a state school, I mean, just a state school, you're going to be six figures in debt. What sort of junk is that? It's like, come on, you do not want them to learn, or do you want them just to be enslaved when they get out? Because if I was 21 or 22 and I came out of university and I had, 100,000 plus in debt, that would change my entire outlook on life. I mean, all the fun
And
you're
I
supposed to.
just,
Go ahead.
oh, I was gonna say, I've always kind of been this way. I knew probably since freshman year I didn't want to go to college.
Good. Good for you.
And I just remember writing a paper my sophomore English class about how I was anti-college, and I specifically said the name of the college that's in my town, Cameron University.
Yeah.
And I just remember my teacher reading it. He goes, "What's wrong with Cameron?" And I look up, and behind him is his his diploma
Oh
on the wall, and
no. Again, you weren't taking a shot at Cameron. You were just saying, hey, look, he doesn't want to go to college. Yeah.
And my brother started, and then he decided, I don't want to do this. He dropped out and became a welder.
Good. Welders make good money.
And I've decided I'm gonna try to be a fireman, firefighter.
Awesome, man. Good for you. Seriously, that made my day. I mean, I see too many kids and I get it. It's like when the university's figured out, it's like parents will pay anything to give their kids, a leg up. And it's like, really? So you're going to increase the tuition 1,000% over a span of X number of years? That's your answer? It's like, that's terrible. Come on. How many libraries can you build? Anyway, anything else before I head out?
No, I don't think so. Just,
All right.
I wouldn't mind if you sent me the audio because I couldn't figure out how to
No worries. It's
get
a
this
it, it's
started.
this. I will shoot it to you. I will drop it in the Skype window, 30 seconds after we hang up.
Okay.
Okay?
All right. Thank you.
Hey, have a good day.
All right. You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye.